COVID-19 pandemic has reminded us that grieving is an inevitable part of living. Whether it be the loss of a loved one, the ending of a marriage, the immigration of children, or the experience of retrenchment, loss, which triggers grief, is unavoidable. Join us as we explore how the words good and grief can, with God's help, appear in the same sentence. Join us for Good Grief, a 4-week preaching and study series starting on 11 April.
Good morning, friends, and welcome to worship as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Charles Wesley's famous Easter hymn includes this line. It says, "Love's redeeming work is done." And that is what we are celebrating today, that the love which took Jesus to the cross, the work that Jesus did for us on the cross, it is done, it is sealed by the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And so the life and the joy and the peace and the salvation that is ours because of his resurrection is that which we are celebrating today. And now let's come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Risen Lord Jesus Christ, we gather to adore you. We gather in wonder at the miracle of the resurrection. We gather to celebrate your redeeming and saving love, which sealed our salvation. And I pray that as we worship you today, that that same power that raised you from the dead would be at work in and through us this day. Amen.
Face tomorrow. Let's pray together. Please respond as indicated with the yellow print on screen. What are we to make of this day? When graves are opened, when the dead awaken, when life refuses to be contained, then nothing is impossible, hope is never extinguished, and love is never conquered. We celebrate you today, Jesus, because you have made it clear that death does not have the last word, because you have filled us again with hope and faith, because you have given us a vision of new possibilities, new realities, and new ways of being. Open our minds to believe what we cannot explain. Open our hearts to hope for what we cannot see. Open our lives to live and to love in the midst of death and despair. Let resurrection happen again in us today. Amen.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in.
Today we celebrate God's abundant gifts of amazing grace, of infinite unconditional love, and of unquenchable life. Our worship is a celebration of these gifts and an expression of our deep gratitude. And one of the most profound ways we can express our thanksgiving is through our giving. As we give, we also offer ourselves completely to God, so that both our gifts and our lives may be used by God to bring life to others. Westview's bank details are on screen now, and you can use them to make your offering, or you can wait and give at the end of today's worship. Let's give generously and joyfully in response to the miraculous gift of resurrection and life in Christ.
Good day, Westview. Let's bow our heads for the prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for everything you do for us and the continual blessings you're bringing down on us. I thank you every day that we can wake up to some sunshine. And even on the days when we wake up to the rain, we know that that's a blessing too. I pray your hand over each and every one of us as we keep doing your work and keep bringing your names through to the rest of the people. Amen.
Hi everyone, it's Easter Sunday. Yay! Now I'm sure you've had tons of fun. You spent a lot of time with family, and if you're anything like me, you've had a few of these. But truth be told, you probably had a lot of these, right? Now, as we're enjoying time with family and having loads of Easter eggs, the question to ask is, what is so important about Easter Sunday? Now, quick recap. Now, we've learned that Jesus died for us on the cross, and that was the lesson we learned on Good Friday. Now, quick history lesson. Back in those days, when somebody passed away, how they buried that person is not like we do. They would bury them in a tomb. Now, just imagine this. A tomb is like a big hole in a rock. Now, to close that hole in the rock, they would use another rock. Just imagine how heavy that was. So, seeing as how I don't have a tomb at hand, I'm going to use my marshmallow box as an illustration. So think of this as your tomb. If I can open the tomb, there you go, empty tomb, and then that's the big rock. Now, what they used to do is, with the people who had then passed away back in the day, one of the rituals they had is that on a Sunday, they would go check on the body. So, as we mentioned, Jesus passed away. Now imagine this little marshmallow of mine as Jesus after he passed away. And then they took him to the tomb, our tomb here, put him in the tomb, and then closed the tomb, that big rock. So on Sunday morning, three of Jesus' disciples, who happened to be women, went to the tomb to go check in on Jesus, which is what they did back in those days. Now you can imagine, as they were walking towards the tomb, they were asking themselves, how are they going to open the tomb, because it is that big rock. But now, guess what? As they got to the tomb, the rock had been moved and the tomb was open. Now, as they walked into the tomb, voila, if I can open my tomb, the tomb was empty. There was nobody there. But what they did find was an angel. Now, the angel told them not to be scared. Now, truth be told, if I were to have an encounter with an angel, I would be a little scared. So the angel told them not to be scared. And he also knew that they were looking for Jesus. So he told them that you're looking for Jesus, but he is risen. He is not here. He also then went and told them that they should go and tell Jesus' disciples where he would be so that he would meet them. I mean, isn't that awesome news? Now, what does that mean for you and I? When I think about it, I think, like the women, you and I, knowing about this awesome Savior we have, should actually go and tell people this great, great news that our Savior, Jesus Christ, is risen. So, as you're going to enjoy the rest of your day, as I am sure you will, just be reminded of what is the importance of this day, the fact that our Lord and Savior is risen. So as you enjoy the rest of your day, I am going to enjoy one of these. And just remember always that Jesus loves you, always. All right, I'm out.
And now let's pray together. Once again, please respond as indicated with the yellow print on screen. God, resurrection is not what we expect in our world. On the face of things, life seems to be under threat. Our earth is grieving, our families are fracturing, and our nations are at war. And the light of our hope is growing dim. We need the stone to be rolled away again. Forgive us and all who have failed to honor and preserve life in all its diversity and glory. Forgive us and all who have allowed relationships to become less important than riches or recognition. Forgive us and all who continue to exalt our needs and desires over those of others, and who are prepared to kill to prove it. Forgive us, and all who have grown blind, to all the signs of resurrection that beckon us still. We need the stone to be rolled away again. We need life to break out within us again. We need love to consume us again. Resurrect us today, O Lord, and make us agents of your life wherever dying and grief hold sway. For Jesus' sake, amen. And now we share together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Hello, Westview. Our reading today is from Mark 16, verse 1 to 8, Jesus has risen. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But they looked up and they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell these disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. We thank God for his word.
If you have ever visited Cape Town, you will have seen in the foreshore area of the City Bowl two sections of highway construction that are known as the uncompleted overpasses. They were designed in the 1960s. Work began on them in the early 1970s, and then financial constraints hit and the construction was halted, never to be taken up again. And so for the past 45 years, the incomplete sections of roads have dangled over the foreshore area of the City Bowl. The ending of Mark's Gospel reminds me a little bit of Cape Town's uncompleted overpass. Mark's Gospel ends abruptly where our reading for today ended, right in the middle of the resurrection narrative. We read that the two Marys and Salome are shaken to the core when they arrive at the tomb to anoint Jesus' lifeless body, only to find that the stone has been rolled away from the burial chamber. Entering the tomb with trepidation, they encounter an angel who does what angels do and tells them not to be afraid. And then the angel goes on to say that Jesus is not there because he's risen from the dead. And finally, the angel commissions the woman to become the first witnesses to Jesus' resurrection. They are to go and to tell Peter and the other disciples that Jesus is risen, that they are to leave Jerusalem and go to Galilee, and there they will find Jesus waiting for them. And then in verse 8, Mark tells us how the woman responded to the angel's message. We read, "Trembling and bewildered, the woman went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid." And that's it. That's how the Gospel of Mark ends. It really is a shabby way to end the gospel, isn't it? The other gospel writers go on to tell after Jesus' resurrection about fabulous stories about his post-resurrection appearances. And yet Mark takes a different approach. He finishes with this disturbing picture of shell-shocked women running from the tomb, speechless fear. Mark's ending is even more awkward. In the original Greek, where the sentence ends with a conjunction that should connect the previous action to what comes next. But like Cape Town's overpass, we are left hanging in midair, the story incomplete. There are different theories behind this abrupt ending of Mark's gospel. Some like to think that the last part of Mark's gospel was lost, like the torn out final page of an old book. The NIV version adds 11 verses with an explanatory note that says the earliest manuscripts do not include these verses. And then a second footnote tells us that different ancient manuscripts have got different endings after verse 8. It seems likely that what happened is that after Mark's death, some of the ancient scribes who copied out the gospel for distribution to the Christian communities, they couldn't bear the shabby ending. And so they tied up the loose ends by writing their own neat ending that pulled the gospel all together. But what most scholars agree on is that the last verse written by Mark that is available to us is verse 8. The one which describes the bewildered woman fleeing the empty tomb in fear. In his book, Easter Earthquake, Jim Harnish invites us to consider the possibility that Mark intended his untidy ending. Jim asks, what if Mark's incomplete story serves as an invitation to every one of us to complete the resurrection story with our own story? What if Mark purposely planned for every follower of the risen Christ to add his or her own chapter to the never-ending story of God's work of salvation in a sin-broken world? What if Mark tends for everyone who hears the resurrection story to be sent like those frightened women to carry the good news to a world that never expected it? What if Mark's non-ending is the call for us to get in on the action and become part of a story that never truly ends? A few weeks back, I was interviewed by the youth pastor of a neighboring congregation on the subject of South Africa's Rainbow Nation, whether the idea of the Rainbow Nation was dead or alive, or even if it ever existed. And the youth pastor asked me whether I believe there is hope for South Africa, whether there is hope for this vision of a diverse people beautifully united as one nation. My answer to his question was, that depends. Specifically, hope depends on us. It depends on you and me. Whether the Rainbow Nation is an escapist illusion that avoids hard questions, or whether it's a vision that can lead us forward as a nation, it depends on whether you and I will choose to complete that story by living in hopeful and inclusive resurrection as God's people. And so celebrating Jesus' resurrection is much more than just gathering once a year on Easter Sunday to listen again to the story of the empty tomb. But celebrating Jesus' resurrection happens when we choose to continue writing the as yet incomplete story of God's resurrection power unleashed on a world that is too often characterized by the violence and the darkness and the despair of Good Friday. Friends, as you respond to the invitation to live as resurrection people by continuing to write the story of resurrection through your own lives, may I just flesh out three characteristics of resurrection people. The first thing I want to say is that resurrection people see possibilities where others only see problems. Resurrection people see possibilities where others see problems. Because we worship a risen Christ, we know that the worst thing is never the last thing. The saving power of Jesus' resurrection trumps the devastating evil of the crucifixion. And so we live in the faith that God is the God of the possible. Return with me to that incomplete overpass in Cape Town. And you will discover as you read up on it that for many years this overpass was seen as a problem. It was seen as an eyesore, something that needed to be fixed. Conversations focused on the costs associated either with completing the road network or with demolishing it. But more recently, the possibilities that the overpass presents to the city of Cape Town have been highlighted. The overpass has become a very popular location for film shoots and for fashion shoots, for example. Some years ago, UCT design students were asked to come up with ideas for its use, and there were incredibly creative suggestions that the overpass be turned into an urban park, that a roller coaster be built on it, that it be turned into a skate park, that the area underneath it should be turned into a kind of street cafe area. And so we see that sometimes when we look at things where we should be seeing problems, we are invited to see the possibilities that God would invite us to live into. One of the things we need to realize about seeing possibilities is that it requires us to have fertile imaginations. Walter Brueggemann has written a powerful book called The Prophetic Imagination. And he suggests that we can't proclaim the resurrected Christ unless we allow our imaginations to be captivated by a kingdom vision. And the historical truth of Jesus' resurrection, it unlocks our imagination to see through problems to the kingdom possibilities that are available on the other side of those problems. And so I want to invite you right now to name the problem in the front and center of your heart and of your mind and of your life right now. And having named that problem, I want to invite you just to consider the possibility that God is wanting to show you the possibility that exists on the other side of that problem. For resurrection people see possibilities where others see only problems. The second truth about resurrection people is that resurrection people trust when others are terrified. Resurrection people trust when others are terrified. And so Mark's gospel, it ends with a sheer terror that that the women feel. They're so afraid that Mark tells us that they cannot even speak. It's left to the gospel writer Matthew to tell us how the women pushed through their fear. Matthew also tells us that they are afraid, but then he goes on to tell us two more things about them. He tells us, first of all, that they were afraid yet filled with joy, yet filled with joy. And isn't that our experience, that as we push through our fears and as we follow Christ, even through the things that we are afraid of, we discover that there is a joy and a freedom that results. Often both fear and joy at the thrill of being part of God's resurrection story are our experience, both at the same time. There's a trust that comes because we know that we are playing God's part. We are part of something much bigger. I wonder whether too many of us haven't made an idol of safety. Our fears, the things that we are afraid of, they dominate our thinking and our living. And so they ensure that we always play it safe. And so we miss being a part of the resurrection story. When we play it safe, we're more like Peter in the courtyard, repeatedly denying Christ. When we should be the woman rushing back to spread the good news of Jesus' resurrection. And so I want to invite you just to consider whether there is any fear which has taken up residence in your heart, a fear which is preventing you from witnessing to the power of the resurrection. For resurrection people are people of trust, even in the midst of feeling terrified. The third truth about resurrection people is that resurrection people act when others abdicate. Resurrection people act when others abdicate. Let's return to the start of our story, where Mary and Mary and Salome arrive on the scene with spices ready to anoint Jesus's lifeless body. I wonder whether that decision to go very early in the morning to anoint Jesus's body, I wonder whether that was preceded by a conversation amongst the three of them as to whether it was wise or not for them to do so. Is it possible that they spoke about the danger in a Jerusalem filled with Roman soldiers seeking to remove any troublemakers? Is it possible that they spoke about the danger of associating with the Jesus movement by going to anoint Jesus's body? Or is it possible that they said to themselves, you know what, Jesus is already dead. This problem is bigger than us. Going and anointing his corpse, it's not going to make any difference. Let's rather just stay at home. I guess we'll never know whether such conversations did or didn't take place amongst them. But what we do know is that the three women showed up. What we do know is that they acted. What we do know is that they did what they could. Insignificant though their act of anointing Jesus' body may have seemed in the bigger picture of things. And the result? Well, their decision to show up, to act, it meant that they were in that place where they were able to receive the commission from the angel to become the first people who witnessed to Jesus's power shown in his resurrection from the dead. And so the power of God works through them as a result of their very act of showing up and of doing what they could. And so Mary and Salome, they blaze a trail for all resurrection people who follow them. For resurrection people refuse to abdicate responsibility. They refuse to abdicate responsibility for their neighbor, or for creation, or for the work of God's kingdom. Instead, as resurrection people, we have an ethic of action. We refuse to be armchair critics or cynics. We refuse to be Pilate washing our hands of situations that are difficult. We believe that the smallest action, no matter how seemingly insignificant, can in the hands of a mighty God achieve things through the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. The great Italian composer Giacomo Puccini began work on his opera Turandot in 1924. But he died before it was completed. Puccini's protege, Franco Alfano, he completed the opera based on the outlines that Puccini had left behind. And the first performance of the opera was in Milan on the 25th of April, 1926. The conductor, Arturo Toscanini, held up the baton. And when they reached the point in the opera where Puccini's work ended, Toscanini abruptly stopped the performance. He laid down the baton. He turned to the stunned audience and he said, "Here, the maestro died." And then he turned, he walked away from the podium, the curtain came down, and the astonished audience went home with the incompleted opera ringing in their ears. The following day, the orchestra returned and the opera was completed with Alfano's ending. And that's the way that this opera has been performed ever since. Other endings have been written by other musicians just the way that other endings are tacked onto the ending of Mark's gospel. Friends, the abrupt ending of Mark's gospel, it invites you and me, each one of us, to complete the resurrection with our own story, as we seek to live as resurrection people with courage, with imagination, with determination, and with trust. And as we do so, the power of the resurrection continues to bring life and hope and healing and salvation. And that will be your experience as you continue the story of God's resurrection power in your own life. Amen. Friends, what a joy it is for us to celebrate in Holy Communion on this Easter Sunday. Many of you will have collected the consecrated communion elements from the church office during Holy Week, and I invite you to prepare those now so that you are ready to receive them at the appropriate moment. I invite you to respond with the words that are in yellow on the screen. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's celebrate this irrepressible life. Let's open our hearts to the joy and wonder of infinite possibility, of unquenched hope, of eternal resurrection. We celebrate, we raise our voices and our hearts in worship and thanksgiving to the God who lives. Resurrection happened because Christ was first prepared to die. Defying death, he refused to release his hold on life and love. And so now, as he encouraged us, we choose to remember so that we too can truly live. At supper on the night before he died, Jesus took bread and blessed it. Then he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken so that you may know life. Eat it and remember me." After the meal, Jesus took wine and blessed it. Then he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my blood, shed so that you may know life. Drink it and remember me." And so now, Lord of life, we share in this meal. We celebrate together. And we remember you. And we will continue to do this until resurrection has flooded the whole creation. Amen. May this bread and this wine become for us in this moment your life-giving body and blood. And may we who share this meal be joined with you and with one another as one body united in resurrection life, and sharing with all of creation in your eternal salvation. Amen. As we break this bread, we receive Christ's life in all our diversity, with all our individuality. We share this one loaf. We are one. And so, friends, as we share in communion now, as I share in communion now, I invite you to take the elements that you have at home and to share in God's resurrection power and grace in this moment now. And now will you join with me in prayer? Oh God, we thank you that we get to share in your resurrection power as we share in the sacrament. We thank you that as we go from this place to live out our own stories of resurrection, that your grace and your mercy and the power of your Spirit is at work in and through us. And thank you that we have been fed and nourished through this meal. Amen.
I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee, but they would not dance and they would not follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John, they came with me. And the dance went on. Dance then, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I'll lead you all, wherever you may be. And I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Sabbath and I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped and they hung. With the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone. But I am the dance and I still go on. Dancing wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. And I'll lead you all wherever you may be. And I'll lead you all in the dance, said he.
And now as we bring this Easter Sunday worship time to a close, let's greet each other. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen. Go in the power of the resurrection to live and to share life wherever you may be, and have a truly blessed Easter.